Dr. Enstrom?
Yes, can you hear me?
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to call Dr. James Enstrom. Yes, doctor, we can hear you. We're ready for your testimony. Thank you for being here by way of Skype this morning. We've heard from Dr. Dunn. We've heard from another witness, and we're ready for you at this point. Would you tell us first your credentials and your experience briefly with CARB, please, sir?
Yes. My name is James Enstrom. I have been an epidemiologist at the UCLA School of Public Health since 1973. I have a PhD in elementary particle physics from Stanford University, and I have a master's in public health from UCLA in epidemiology. And for the last 15 years or so, I've specialized in air pollution epidemiology, and I have produced a number of significant findings that counter the science and regulations of EPA and CARB, especially regarding the health effects of fine particulate air pollution. And that's what I would like to speak about today.
Doctor, I'm going to ask you, when we're finished, I've already asked the hearing officer to remind me, if you will remind me to be sure and see if there are any questions for you from the members of our hearing board. I'm going to put the responsibility on all three of us. Remember that.
That's fine.
All right, sir. Go ahead. And I know that you have a message that you want to deliver to the board. So if you would do that, remembering that what we want them to do is to understand as much as possible exactly what is happening and what's being done.
Yes, this is fine. My talk is going to be on the subject, combating environmental Nazism in California. And there is going to be two parts. And the reason I use the word Nazism is because I've been involved now for a decade in trying to get CARB to listen to my research, listen to the arguments of people like John Dunn, and to listen in a way that they actually will do something to align their regulations with actual evidence on health effects, particularly of diesel particulate matter and diesel exhaust. But during that entire period, they've absolutely refused to behave professionally or responsibly to the citizens of California. So I've escalated this from environmental extremism in California to environmental Nazism. And I think what I want you to understand, using a historical perspective, and I found one of the most powerful statements of evil that I've ever seen was in a movie called Judgment at Nuremberg. It came out in 1961. It had an all-star cast headed by Spencer Tracy and Burt Lancaster. And I would like Robert to play, before I go into my talk, I'd like Robert to play a 9-minute clip from that movie by Burt Lancaster portraying the role of Dr. Ernst Jahning, the Minister of Justice for the Third Reich. And this is how the judge, the lead legal scholar in Germany, allowed things to happen which were totally wrong and immoral and illegal. And I want to relate, after this talk, I want to relate it to the situation here in California. And so can you proceed with the clip from Judgment at Nuremberg?
Feldenstein case, because it was the most significant trial of the period. It is important, not only for the tribunal to understand it, but for the whole German people. But in order to understand it, one must understand the period in which it happened. There was a fever over the land, a fever of disgrace, of indignity, of hunger. We had a democracy, yes, but it was torn by elements within. Above all, there was fear. Fear of today, fear of tomorrow, fear of our neighbors, and fear of ourselves. Only when you understand that, can you understand what Hitler meant to us. Because he said to us, lift your heads, be proud to be German. There are devils among us, communists, liberals, Jews, gypsies. Once these devils will be destroyed, your misery will be destroyed. It was the old, old story of the sacrificial lamb. What about those of us who knew better? We who knew the words were lies and worse than lies? Why did we sit silent? Why did we take part? Because we loved our country. What difference does it make if a few political extremists lose their rights? What difference does it make if a few racial minorities lose their rights? It is only a passing phase. It is only a stage we are going through. It will be discarded sooner or later. Hitler himself will be discarded sooner or later. The country is in danger. We will march out of the shadows. We will go forward. Forward is the great password. And history tells how well we succeeded, Your Honor. We succeeded beyond our wildest dreams. The very elements of hate and power about Hitler that mesmerized Germany, mesmerized the world. We found ourselves with sudden powerful allies. Things that had been denied to us as a democracy were open to us now. The world said, go ahead. Take it. Take it! Take Sudetenland! Take the Rhineland! Remilitarize it! Take all of Austria! Take it! And then one day, we looked around and found that we were in an even more terrible danger. The ritual began in this courtroom, swept over the land like a raging, roaring disease. What was going to be a passing phase had become the way of life. Your Honor, I was content to sit silent during this trial. I was content to tend my roses. I was even content to let counsel try to save my name, until I realized that in order to save it, you would have to raise the specter again. You have seen him do it. He has done it here in this courtroom. He has suggested that the Third Reich worked for the benefit of people. He has suggested that we sterilized men for the welfare of the country. He has suggested that perhaps the old Jew did sleep with the 16-year-old girl after all. Once more, it is being done for love of country. It is not easy to tell the truth. But if there is to be any salvation for Germany, we who know our guilt must admit it. Whatever the pain and humiliation. I had reached my verdict on the Feldenstein case before I ever came into the courtroom. I would have found him guilty, whatever the evidence. It was not a trial at all. It was a sacrificial ritual. in which Feldenstein the Jew was the helpless victim.
Your Honor, I must interrupt. The defendant is not aware of what he's saying. He's not aware of the implications.
I am aware. I am aware. My counsel would have you believe we were not aware of the concentration camps. Not aware. Where were we? Where were we when Hitler began shrieking his hate in the Reichstag? Where were we when our neighbors were being dragged out in the middle of the night to Dachau? Where were we when every village in Germany has a railroad terminal, where cattle cars were filled with children being carried off to their extermination? Where were we when they cried out in the night to us? Were we deaf? Dumb?
That's enough. Are you, is that complete?
Yes, yes it is, Doctor. Would you go ahead?
Okay. All right, now, I realize this is maybe a little over the top, but not much by my perspective. Now, if you could switch to the PowerPoint that I have.
Trying.
We're doing it.
All right, it's up, Doctor.
Okay. All right, now, basically, I'll just go through the slides one at a time and give you a little background. So the first slide is my basic identification information. I have a website where I have tremendous... Can you hear me all right?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Oh, there we are. Okay, here we go. Okay.
You have the...
Yes.
The first slide...
first slide.
...on now?
Yes.
Okay. And my website, scientificintegrityinstitute.org, contains a tremendous number of documents, especially during the last decade, regarding CARB diesel regulations and other related information. I note that this is Friday the 13th. It's a very ominous day, but we will proceed as if this will work out in quite a good manner. If you... go to the next slide, the second slide.
It's there.
The timing here is almost amazing. On Wednesday, the 11th, Lois Henry, who's been covering the CARB issue and also my situation at UCLA, wrote an incredibly powerful column about me, entitled UCLA's Immense Power Couldn't Squash This David. And two sentences from that column, which people can find on the internet. The reality of our world is that sometimes David slays Goliath, and sometimes he has to settle for giving the big Philistine a black eye. It's not the full vindication I believe he was due, but Enstrom was up against a monster and he knew it. This is the battle that I've had for the last 5 years against UCLA to silence me from doing what I'm trying to do right now. And this relates, in order to understand how well she wrote this, you need to read the phrase from the Holy Bible. I always like the King James Version. This is the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 49. And David put his hand in his bag and took hence stone and slang it and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead and he fell upon his face to the earth. The meaning of this in this situation is that you can combat CARB if you know how to aim the stone and sling it properly. And this is the same thing that I've done in my battle against UCLA, which has allowed me to continue to be a scientist. My career's been heavily damaged, but I'm still alive and fighting. And so we'll now go to the next slide. In terms of my motivation, I want people to understand that I feel compelled to do this because of my situation, not because I have any interest specifically in the businessmen in the room, but I care about all of you, and I care about California and the United States, and I care above all about honest science. And my situation is that I was fortunate enough to be trained at Stanford by a Nobel laureate named Melvin Schwartz. And later, I learned, I didn't know this at the time because he hadn't won the Nobel Prize when I worked for him and earned my degree in 1970. But then I learned he was trained by Jack Steinberg, who also won the Nobel Prize. And Jack Steinberger was trained by Nobel laureate Enrico Fermi. And the amazing sequence here is that, and the reason that I used the clip from Judgment at Nuremberg, is that in order for Steinberger to become a scientist, he had to escape Germany in 1934 when he was 11 years old. And he was able to effectively be adopted by a grain merchant in Chicago, and that allowed him then to subsequently earn his PhD at the University of Chicago from Enrico Fermi. And that in turn made it possible for me to have the career that I've had. Now, if people are not familiar with Enrico Fermi, he's the one that the scientist who achieved a sustained thermonuclear reaction at the University of Chicago football stadium in 1942 that led to the atomic bombs that ended the Second World War. Many people believe that he was a major player in helping the United States defeat Germany and Japan. And we have a current situation. Things are never over until you have to be vigilant. We now have a situation in Iran. If Iran gets nuclear weapons, that could be a terrible tragedy for the world. But I'm driven by the fact that I have this opportunity to understand real honest science and have touched some of the greatest scientists that that lived during the 20th century. Now we go to the next slide. This is why you have different types of science. Physics is a rigorous experimental science where you can test specific hypotheses and prove that they're correct. And these findings are worthy of an annual Nobel Prize, such as the one my dissertation advisor one for discovering an elementary particle. The chronic disease epidemiology, which I've also been trained in at UCLA, is a completely different type of science. It's observational in the sense that you examine people as they function in normal life, but you can't really do experiments on them. Other than the type, I believe Dr. Dunn explained some experiments that CARB or scientists at UCLA and USC were doing on subjects by exposing them to diesel exhaust. But in general, you cannot do anything other than observe the development of disease over a long period of time and associate that with factors that the subjects have. And these findings are often very weak and inconsistent and that cannot be independently verified. And go to the next slide, please. Regarding the specific issue that we're dealing with here, this is fine particulate matter that's defined by its size, less than 2.5 micrometers in diameter. You cannot see this. It's on the order of some people have said on the order of 1/70th the diameter of a human hair. But the major sources in California are forest fires, agricultural dust, industrial combustion, residential burning, diesel engines, which are now estimated to contribute only about 5%, and China, which now contributes possibly up to as much as 30% of the fine particulate air pollution. And the air pollution epidemiology for PM2.5 has been used to establish these scientifically contested regulations that you're dealing with. And they have major impacts in California and the United States. And this really started with a regulation EPA implemented in 1997 called the National Ambient Air Quality Standard set. It's currently now 12 micrograms per cubic meter. And this has led to the truck and bus regulation and to other regulations down here in Southern California by the South Coast Air Quality Management District. Now we go to the next slide. What is this that you're inhaling or that you're exposed to? Well, these are some simple calculations that you can do. These came from another professor at UC Irvine that I've worked with closely during the past several years, Professor Robert Phelan. During a lifetime, a human will consume or inhale on the order of close to 300 million cubic meters of air. And if you inhale at the current or at the level of the PM2.5 that has been in up until recently, the 15 micrograms, if you inhale 15 micrograms per cubic meter over this lifetime, you do the calculation, it comes out on the order of 4 grams. Now 4 grams over 80 years is about 1 teaspoon over 80 years. To understand how little that is, that's what's basically in a bag of sugar that you pour in your coffee. And it's also you're only inhaling the diesel particulate matter portion, now estimated in California to be about 5% of the total, is only about 0.04 teaspoons. And that's equivalent to on the order of, say, 5 cigarettes, inhaling the particulate matter in 5 cigarettes. So these are incredibly small amounts. And it makes no sense how such a small amount of particulate matter consumed over a lifetime could kill people. And so that's why this has been controversial ever since the first major paper on this came out in 1993, and then there was a major paper by the American Cancer Society in 1995. They've been contested ever since they came out for reasons such as I'm presenting now. Now we go to the next slide. The only reason that there's a justification for the regulations that you face is because of the notion that fine particulate air pollution causes premature deaths. And in terms of epidemiologic terms, that means that the death rate is elevated among subjects who are exposed to higher levels of fine particulate air pollution. And then EPA makes a somewhat arbitrary assumption that each life lost is worth $9 million. And then this quickly turns into billions of dollars of supposed health savings if you can prevent these premature deaths. But without the premature deaths, the CARB and EPA regulations are not justified on any kind of fair socioeconomic cost-benefit basis. Now this is a, now we switch to the next slide, which is a map of the United States showing fine particulates and mortality risk. And this came out of a paper in 2000 by a Canadian group that was working for the Health Effects Institute. That's the HEI stands for Health Effects Institute in Boston. And this covered data from an American Cancer Society study that dealt with the period 1982-1989. And as you can see from this map, the mortality risk is focused primarily in the Rust Belt, back in the area of Ohio, Kentucky, West Virginia, Pennsylvania. And the risk actually in California is modest. And I'll go into that a little in the next slide. But the point is here, 15 years ago, EPA and CARB knew that the risk was not high in California. And so this is even before I actually, this is about the time I began looking into this matter. Okay, I actually started in 2002. So we go to the next slide. This, again, I'm going through this rather rapidly, and you can go back to the extent you need to and look more into this. I wrote a major paper in 2012 as part of an American Statistical Association meeting held in San Diego that included a group of us who presented evidence that fine particulate air pollution wasn't killing people in California. And this is a summary of that evidence. And again, it's a little detailed for people that haven't seen any epidemiologic findings before. But basically, starting in 2000, evidence was produced showing the RR stands for relative risk. That means that the risk increases as you increase the exposure to PM2.5 by 10 micrograms per cubic meter. And you see all of the RRs there are essentially consistent with 1.00. If you average them all, they probably exactly come out to 0.00. That means there's no increase in mortality with an increase in fine particulate air pollution. And I even have a new study that I'm working on right now that covers up to 2010. A lot of this data started in the 80s, particularly the what's known as the Cancer Prevention Study 2 or CPS2 data that's cited in there. That data is from the 1980s. We're now in the year 2015. So the evidence overwhelming is that there's no relationship between fine particulate air pollution and total mortality in California. And this is something that CARB refuses to acknowledge and refuses to act on because it has a direct relevance to the missile regulation. The next, we go to the next slide. This is the House Science Committee issued a subpoena, and this matter has gotten the attention of the Congress of the United States, and during the period 2011 to 2013, they wrote numerous letters to EPA citing many of the arguments Dr. Dunn and I have raised over the last decade. They've become very familiar with the weaknesses of the data that EPA uses. And so they finally could not get anything directly from EPA during that period. And then in August 1st of 2013, they subpoenaed the secret science data, as they define it, which is the basis for the notion that fine particulate air pollution causes deaths. And this involves data mainly that comes from what is really an unlikely source. It's the American Cancer Society based in Atlanta, Georgia, and they have a Cancer Prevention Study 2 database that started in 1982, and that's the primary source of the data. 99% of the data comes from that source. And the American Cancer Society has refused to comply with the subpoena, even though the basic request was for de-identified data that could be independently analyzed. And this is, again, related to the map that I showed you. That was done as part of an attempt to reanalyze the data. But again, the underlying data for that map is not even properly released. And they've refused to cooperate with in any meaningful way with highly qualified critics like myself, and Dr. Dunn, and Dr. Stan Young, and numerous other scientists around the country. And for some reason, the American Cancer Society is heavily involved with this regulatory policy because they don't back off. They will not back off in spite of the number of objections that have been raised and concerns raised to their data. And even more amazingly, it appears that they violated their own confidentiality requirements by allowing home addresses to be released to investigators. The primary one here located in California, Dr. Michael Jarrett, in spite of their own agreement with the subjects in 1982 to never release home addresses. So we don't know why, but the American Cancer Society is a major player in this, and they don't seem to be willing to cooperate. So now we go to the next slide. Here are some overall conclusions that I have regarding the situation about air pollution and total mortality in California. There's overwhelming evidence in California that there's no premature death due to any particular air pollution or other forms of air pollution, PM10 or ozone. There's also a need for the American Cancer Society to comply with the subpoena that the House issued in order to get past this notion that these regulations are based on secret science. And given this situation, EPA and CARB should freeze the regulations here in California pending the outcome of investigation of these findings. And furthermore, there should be some context, and this is where CARB is not putting anything into context. You need the socioeconomic consequences of these regulations, which I understand a number of businessmen are talking about at your hearing today. Also, you need to understand that California is an extremely healthy state. We have one of the lowest death rates in the entire country. Really, the only state with any substantially lower death rate is Hawaii, and that's mainly because it has a very large Asian population, and Asians have the lowest death rates of any ethnic group. And then there has to be some consideration that there's so much air pollution coming from China, which ignores these type of regulations, that it now exceeds the air pollution from PM2.5 due to diesel trucks. These things all are not being considered by CARB. Let's go to the next slide. All right, now, this is where I use historical analogies to bad science. And this I presented in a conference that I had involving truckers in 2009. This is a plant geneticist in the Soviet Union who believed in proper plant genetics and was properly trained as a scientist. Unfortunately, he lost out to, his name was Vavilov. He lost out to this man, Lysenko, because Lysenko was very closely aligned with Joseph Stalin. And he believed in phony plant genetics. Not going to go into the specifics here, but they were there were things that Stalin wanted to promote. So basically, Lysenko prevailed during this period, and Vavilov died in a prison. And I put a quick summary here. Lysenko, a non-scientist, gained the favor of Stalin. He made false crop claims and used phony plant genetics. He ignored genuine Mendelian plant genetics. He purged opposing scientists like Vavilov. Famines resulted, and Soviet citizens starved to death. And Soviet agriculture has never come back and is far behind American agriculture. Now, there is an analogy with fine particulate matter pseudoscience, because it's controlled by a few activist scientists who publish most of the major papers, and dissenting scientists like myself, Dr. Dunn, Dr. Young, and so forth are basically ignored. We can never get funding that would allow us to compete in a fair manner with the scientists that are funded by CARB and EPA. And then you have findings based on secret science that can't be checked. You have that these, as I said, primarily come from the American Cancer Society. There's activists that are involved in this, like the American Lung Association, the Union of Concerned Scientists, the Natural Resources Defense Council. They participate in lawsuits with EPA, CARB, and continue to exaggerate health effects. And then, as a result, we have these draconian regulations on fine particulate air pollution in the healthy state of California, and truckers, contractors, farmers, loggers, a whole series of people in California are hurt by these regulations. And this is the, what I say, the ultimate example that you just saw. This is where a justice system, and I compare this to the justice system here in California, sits by and lets illegal things happen. And part of this talk that you just heard from Bert Lancaster as Ernst Jonning is the case of Lehman Feldenstein. And he was basically a sacrificial lamb, as was described in that clip. And in other words, a person that can, the country will be improved by removing people like Feldenstein. Well, in many ways, and I know this is a little bit of an exaggeration, but people like Mary Nichols are claiming that truckers are the sacrificial lambs in California. If you just remove them because of their dirty diesel trucks that are killing people, then California will be a better place. Well, it's all lies. It's the same kind of lies that Jonning was talking about. And what I want you to do is motivate yourself to realize you're not going to be the sacrificial lambs in this state. You're harming anyone. This is a complete, total misrepresentation of evidence, and it's being perpetrated by very powerful people that are doing very dishonest things. Now, we go to the next. Here's how I say that you combat this environmental Nazism in California. And again, you do it by doing what David did. You aim the pebble at the right people. And the right people are not going at Mary Nichols. She's extremely strong. She has an army of people behind her all over the country. These Natural Resources Defense Council, she has the Attorney General of California behind her, and above all, she has the governor behind her. But what you can do is you can go to the UC professors. Unfortunately, I don't like to go against my university. I've been affiliated with the University of California since 1971 and at UCLA since 1973. And this hurts me.
Probably CARB intercepting this, calling us up. Is he trying?
Well, I dropped, he dropped me, so I'm assuming that finds you.
Are you ready for me to start again? Do you have the PowerPoint up?
Yeah, I'm getting it. There we go, full screen. Okay, we're at the health and safety code section.
Go back back one slide.
Okay, combating environmental Nazis.
Okay, so here are four ways that I believe that are realistic and that you're aiming at the weak points. Here, and that is, you publicize how UC professors and the American Cancer Society allow CARB to destroy innocent California businessmen with illegal diesel vehicle regulations. And in many ways, I've heard of stories where they just literally terrorize these businessmen with threats and so forth. Then you challenge this UC scientists and the American Cancer Society and demand that CARB immediately stop and reassess its diesel regulations. Then you strongly support the congressional approval of H.R. 1030, the Secret Science Reform Act of 2015, which may actually come before the House next week. I've heard estimates it may come up Tuesday of next week. So the timing is perfect, and you make sure that your representatives know about this. In particular, there's a representative in the Eastern Sacramento area named Amy Berra, and he opposes this, okay, as do most of the Democratic congressional people in California. But you can speak out if you want to help this. It's because of the elections last November, the bill will pass the House, but it's important that it get as much support as possible. And ideally it should get 2/3 of the House. It won't reach that level, it'll probably reach 60%. Because if someone in the White House is gonna veto this. But listen, you move as best you can, as far as you can. And then the last point is stop supporting University of California and the American Cancer Society until they stop the illegal CARB regulations. And they can do this by the number of people involved at the University of California and the American Cancer Society. They can stop these regulations by just asking CARB to do it. Okay, now, next, do the next slide. Here is the basis for stopping the regulations. And I've tried this ever since 2008, and CARB's not gonna do it. They're gonna block you. They're gonna tell you to pound sand. This is a provision in the California Health and Safety Code. It's section 39662, the section that deals with the scientific review panel. And I'll read it so that you understand how you can actually stop these regulations. It's section 39662E. Any person may petition the state board to review a determination made pursuant to this section. The petition shall specify the additional scientific evidence regarding the health effects of a substance which was not available at the time the original determination was made, and any other evidence which could justify a revised determination. Now, unfortunately, all petitions challenging the 1998 identification of diesel particulate matter as a toxic air contamination have been rejected or ignored in spite of massive change in evidence regarding diesel health effects and diesel exposure in California. We have now established that it's not killing anyone, there's very little exposure, and there's even different type of diesel now than there was in 1998. So we're 17 years down the road, and CARB will not even follow the law as specified in the California Health and Safety Code by reevaluating this. So what you can do is submit another petition and submit the petition to the scientific review panel members. They're the ones that voted on this in 1998 and have never been able or never reconsidered it. And here is the way I consider, if you go within the certain scientific review panel members are stronger than others, and certain universities within the University of California are stronger than others. You don't go at the University of California at Berkeley. That is an area where you will get no traction, unfortunately, very sad. You don't go at the University of California, San Francisco either. These two institutions don't care about businessmen like you. In fact, in many ways, I think they really do think of you as sacrificial lambs. But you do go at UC Davis. And I believe that's in an agricultural section of the state. It has a somewhat more moderate composition. But really, I've identified seven activists within the University of California, Davis. The number one is Daniel Sperling, who's the CARB board member who should represent the automotive industry. But basically, he's promoting his own views on sustainable transportation and so forth. And I listed the salaries of these people, just to give you an idea of what you're paying for as California citizens. You're paying for these people, and you have a right to protest what they're doing and plead with them. So he's number one. The second is Kurt Anastasio, who is a professor, but actually, if you look, and I get this information off a website called this, Sacramento Bee State pay website, and you can look up the pay of any employee in the state of California that's paid by the taxpayers. But he's actually listed as an agronomist at the Agricultural Experimental Station. So I'm not sure why he's listed that way, but that's the way he's paid. But he also has titles as professor. But I'm not sure what an agronomist at the Agricultural Experimental Station has to do with expertise in atmospheric science as a CARB scientific review panel member. That's a legitimate question you can ask. Ask for an explanation. Another key person is a person in my profession, Irva Hertz-Picotto. She's a professor of epidemiology. She was on, for many years, on this CARB research screening committee that selects projects like the ones that were done by Professor Jarrett, and also reject the proposals submitted by me and others who are critics of CARB. She's very highly paid, and she understands the science, the epidemiology, probably better than anyone on this particular page. Another is Kent Pinkerton, who's a professor of veterinary medicine and is a heavily funded EPA and CARB investigator who's worked a lot in the San Joaquin Valley, doing research in the San Joaquin Valley. And again, and someone that I've interacted with who absolutely just, he studies mainly animals. I study humans, okay? You've got to convince these people that it's the humans that are the ones that are being affected here. And it's the human health effects that are important, not what it does to animals. Then you've got four professors. Then you've got three graduates. The head of the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, George Alexeff, got his PhD at UC Davis studying the toxic effects of methyl bromide in mice. Okay? So he's the one that has provided a lot of the scientific evidence to the scientific review panel, which then approves it. Another person, Melanie Marty, she's a very mean-spirited scientist. I've run up against her now for more than a decade, and her expertise, a PhD from UC Davis, is the metabolism of milkweed and butterfly larvae. So these people have no training in epidemiology, statistics, or the toxicology of diesel particulate matter. And then seventh, and maybe the most widely known, is a person that I uncovered back in 2008, Dr. Hien T. Tran, who has his master's of science and statistics from UC Davis, and claimed to have a PhD in statistics from UC Davis until we found out that it was actually from a mail order house named Thornhill University. But he's still employed. That was in 2008. He's still employed as an air pollution specialist. His report that was from 2008 has been totally discredited, but he's earning almost $100,000 of taxpayer money in this state. So you have a legitimate right to go at these people and ask them to respond. Why are they beating on people like you in the audience? And why should this continue? And here is a final way of approaching the University of California. And this comes from other issues, but it sort of is an example of why there are problems at the University of California. And this has just come up in the last couple of weeks. There's now a proposed constitutional amendment to prevent the banning of the U.S. flag on UC campuses. And this was an incident at UC Irvine, where several students didn't want the flag flown in their office complex. How outrageous can you be? And this has generated a lot of concern among many people, all nationwide. I mean, this issue has gotten nationwide attention because it's just so outrageous that these students can't understand the significance of the U.S. flag. And the second is the number of legislators, even the governor, have been upset with the lack of transparency at the University of California. And there's now a constitutional amendment that's been proposed to take the oversight away from the UC Regents and give it to the legislature, as the situation exists right now with the Cal State universities. This would be a major change, because for the roughly 150 years that the university has existed, it's always been had oversight from the UC Regents. But this shows, again, an opening that there's concern within the legislature for problems that aren't being addressed by the Regents. There's also, amazingly, and this is down here at UCLA a lot, but it's in other campuses as well, they're now checking the religious background of certain students that want to participate in various student government activities. And this religious background check relates back to what was going on in Germany in the 1930s. I don't think I need to tell you which religion they're trying to check on. Next, another issue is efforts to ban investments in Israel by the University of California. Again, these are things that haven't actually taken place, but they're being proposed. And so what I'm saying is, you have opportunities. If you want to use them, if you take the efforts that Fred Kelly Grant and the others that you've heard from are doing, we build off of these things, you can go at these people from a perspective that you hit them at their weakest point and you make them stop. Otherwise, the public support for the University of California is going to continue to erode, and the House of Representatives is going to continue to get stronger with regard to its opposition to these regulations, because what has happened historically is that California regulations and policies have spread across the country. But we have a totally different situation now in Congress. They're not going to put up with this anymore. And so you've got help from Congress, you've got help from a number of people like myself, Dr. Dunn, and a whole group of scientists that want this stuff corrected. And so I think that this process can be just continued, and you can reverse this, and you can actually stop these regulations. And so that's basically the major points that I want to make, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure if there are questions from the board. I do.
Dr. Mitch Mashburn here with the City of Vacaville, and I have two questions for you. The first is, given your expertise in epidemiology, can you let me enlighten us as to whether there have been any studies on specific subjects who have a greater than normal exposure to this type of particulate matter? In other words, what we heard in earlier testimony was that there were studies done of 50,000 people in California on a fairly random scale. In other studies that are done on other types of carcinogens, cigarettes as an example, they talk to smokers. They follow them, they track them, and they determine if over a period of time there's a causation as a result of smoking that involves cancer or any of those other types of diseases. Has anybody done a study of truckers? Has anybody done a study based on all the the epidemiological factors of diesel mechanics. Has anybody done a study of any of those populations to determine if, given their exposure, there's a greater level of deaths as a result of participating in those trades? Can anybody say that there is an algorithm out there that proves that, given their participation in those trades? That's my first question.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, there's some individuals there at the meeting that could inform you of this. There are some major studies done on truckers that have been published, and they show that the truckers actually have lower than normal death rates for the general population. And this makes a certain degree of sense because you have to be in good health to be driving a truck.
Yep. But my understanding is that particulate matter kills 300,000 people in the United States annually. I'm sure most of those have to be truckers, right?
Well, look, the evidence on the truckers, and I think there's the two people in the audience that I think could cite you the references. I didn't reference those studies. Betty Plowman and Hank DeCarbonell can point you to publications from their own organization, the California Construction Trucking Association, where these studies are laid out. The whole point of my presentation is that the claim that of these premature deaths is not legitimate, or it's based on secret science, and that's why many of us want to get at the bottom of this. How such a tiny amount of particulate matter on the order of a teaspoon over a lifetime can kill someone is just not believable to people like us. And so even though the claim is made, I don't consider it legitimate, and many others don't consider it legitimate, but we're basically shut out by EPA and CARB.
That's a great segue into my next question, Doc, and it's my last question. I know we're getting close to lunch and everybody wants to get out of here, but my question is this. The particulate matter that we're talking about, in those studies that have been done, are there, and can you share with us, are there any direct links to known carcinogens? In other words, we see a lot of very technical information up here about the particulate matter and the amount of particulate matter. We know that in a cigarette there are carcinogens such as tar and nicotine. They are poisons. Those poisons and elements that are in cigarette smoke have been determined to have direct links to heart disease, to cancer, to those things. In the diesel experiments, what are the carcinogens and what are the levels of carcinogen that are there? We're talking about eight one-hundredths of a teaspoon of material. In that material, what is in that that I'm going to ingest over the next 80 years that is so poisonous that it's going to, I'm doomed?
Well, I'm saying that there's nothing in it that's lethal. And the analogy there is if the estimates vary depending on exactly what parameters you have, but say this is equivalent. What you're exposed to as a person exposed to diesel exhaust is equivalent to about smoking 5 cigarettes in a lifetime. Now that's not enough to kill you. It's smoking regularly, say one pack a day for many decades, that causes the lung cancer and other health problems, but not smoking 5 cigarettes. So the whole basis of this is just not there from the perspective of scientists like myself. And that's why it's been contentious ever since the major publications came out starting in 1993. It's just not plausible. But the way this has worked its way through EPA and CARB is they continue to force it on, we're speaking now in California, so on Californians. And then EPA has also got a number of other regulations that are based on this notion that fine particulate air pollution is lethal. And that's where you pay attention now to the Secret Science Reform Act. This will be discussed. They have They have this webcast, so you can watch it on the internet. You just have to find the exact timing. I'm not sure if it's been scheduled specifically, but it could be next Tuesday. And that's where you get a perspective. This is why there's so much concern in Congress about this, because it's just not plausible. And these regulations have major impacts on so many sectors of the economy in the United States, with power plants and with just general ability to do manufacturing and so forth.
Thank you, Doctor. I appreciate that. I'm going to pass the mic to any other member on the panel who wanted to have another question.
Thank you, Doctor. I have just a couple of quick questions. Can you explain the reasoning to me behind including diesel particulate matter as an airborne pollutant, considering basically diesel particulate matter is soot, which is considered inert and settles almost immediately to the ground once airborne?
Well, this was a big issue that was discussed in 1998. And originally, they had declared diesel exhaust as a whole to be a toxic air contaminant, but then they limited it only to diesel particulate matter for the very reason that you're discussing. And what I'm saying is the evidence regarding diesel particulate matter is not there either. So you've raised a good point, but I think that the basis for either diesel exhaust as a whole or diesel particulate matter as being harmful in 2015 to Californians is just not there.
Thank you. And my second question is are you aware of the Data Quality Control Act?
Yes.
Okay. And in your expert opinion, do you believe that CARB's scientific method and findings meet the criteria of the Data Quality Control Act?
Well, I've generally heard it described as the Data Quality Act. Is that, it's basically an effort, again, for transparency in data, and I don't believe it's been met by CARB.
Yes, it specifies that any scientific evidence must be open, presentable, and transparent, and be able to be reproduced by an outside peer group.
Exactly. That's basically the goal of the House subpoena and the goal of HR 1030. And this has been something that's been around now for about 15 years. I think this is, you're relating it to the Shelby Amendment from 2000. These are very important policies that are not being followed by the investigators that are being used by EPA and CARB in terms of their scientific findings.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have one more question. A couple more here from the board.
Okay, I have a couple questions. The schools that did the experiments that we talked about earlier, why aren't they getting prosecuted? What's the list of the schools? I mean, we know about UCLA. You referenced USC. We talked about UNC, University of North Carolina. Why aren't things going forward with that? I mean, that's a pretty clear-cut deal.
That's a little out of my knowledge base. I believe what you could do is, most of this was done at USC, to my knowledge. You could actually look up the specific investigators. In fact, I know some of them personally, and raise this question with them. I'm sure they're going to have good answers that they were doing nothing wrong. But you have them in a situation where there's a complete contradiction here. EPA knows that diesel exhaust is not lethal. That's why they allowed these studies to go forward in the first place, and they know that the universities approved their the studies because they know this is not lethal, but they wanted to study the effects on the subjects. And so this is where you show the inconsistency of EPA. They allow studies on subjects exposed to diesel exhaust, knowing that it's not lethal, but then they issue regulations making the claim that it is lethal. So these are contradictions that you should raise, and I encourage you to contact the professors at UC to explain the issues that we're just discussing right now.
I think we have one more. I'm sorry, two more.
Hello, Dr. Enstrom. My name is Mike Easter. I know some of your colleagues down at UCLA, the good Dr. Arthur Weiner, Scott Fruin, and Phil Haber. And I've been involved with some diesel work in the past. You mentioned you don't believe with respect to diesel exhaust causing premature deaths in the population, but I believe that one of the other bases for listing it as a toxic air contaminant was from some epidemiology work conducted by Dr. Eric Garshick looking at railroad workers and then estimating potential cancer risks from those exposures. Do you have any thoughts or an opinion as to whether or not that data is still valid, and whether, and if you do, are you familiar with to whether or not there's a dose response that was observed in that? In essence, is there data to that can be used to demonstrate that not only does it not cause premature deaths, but is it still that it doesn't cause cancer?
Well, that's a very good question, because Professor Garshick has played a major role in this now for 20 years. He specifically wrote to the scientific review panel back in the period, I believe, in the mid-90s, and specifically in 1997 and 98 when they were making the decision that his data should not be used for any conclusive purposes regarding establishing a dose response between diesel exhaust and lung cancer. And this is part of other presentations that I've made, and it's part of a letter that I filed with the Office of Administrative Law in California back in 2011. This whole process that CARB used, starting with OHEA, the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, back in approximately 1990, has been using data inappropriately, even against the investigators' wishes. So it's very very appropriate that you raise this, and I would like to engage in a dialogue with you if you'd like further information on this. Just email me and we can exchange more information. It's very interesting also you brought the name of Arthur Weiner. He's one of the people at UCLA who's tried to silence me. And it's very unfortunate, but this is the kind of environment that that's critics like myself work in. And there are concerns. I mean, they've raised legitimate concerns about diesel exhaust over the time period, but they're just way out of proportion to the actual health risks. And I would be pleased to engage with you and provide you with more specifics.
Sure. One other quick question, and that I'm interested to hear your take on. There was a recent study from the Health Effects Institute when the ACEs, the Advanced Collaborative Emission Studies results, looking at the effects of new diesel technology in a lifetime study with rats. And my understanding is they found no significant risk of cancer in the rats. And they're also looking at some genotoxic endpoints, and they found nothing with respect to that. Is that your understanding as well?
I believe that's correct. I haven't examined that report, but again, it's consistent with what I believe is the lack of current evidence on diesel health effects, at least the way they're portrayed by CARB.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we have one more.
Dr. Enstrom, thank you for assisting us today. I'm one of the counsel here, and I have two questions. One, at a prior hearing, you indicated the rail industry, by comparison to the trucking industry and the diesel generator particulates, that the findings were that the rail industry actually was higher than the trucking industry, but that there was some manipulation of that data. Is that something that, did I misunderstand, or is that something you can respond to?
Question didn't come through real clearly to me, but the evidence on railroad workers is some of the work that was originally used, but some of that data is 50 years old, and I'm not sure if it's relevant as relevant as the studies on truckers themselves. And I think there's a lot of evidence on truckers now that can be used directly. And I'm sorry, I think we'd have to go through the question, just missed some of the question because of the audio there.
Is there a difference between the generation of diesel particulates in the railroad industry as compared to the trucking industry?
These things have evolved. The coal that's burned on railroads, I think, has been changed. It's the processes have been changed over the 50 years, and the same way the diesel engines and trucks now are much different than they were 50 years ago. And so there are some similarities because both processes generate fine particulate matter, but I'm not sure that there's a much of a contribution on the railroad worker study anymore regarding the issues that we're talking about now for the CARB regulations.
Okay,
they're based on a different set of epidemiologic studies.
Thank you. And lastly, do you feel like the media, generally speaking, is ignoring this issue? And if so, why?
Well, I believe this is a very serious problem because the major newspaper in my area, the Los Angeles Times, will absolutely refuse to publish anything of the nature that I'm talking about today. All they will do is hype the dangers of diesel and of other toxic substances largely because of their efforts. A battery recycling plant in Los Angeles, downtown Los Angeles, called Exide, which has been in existence for about 90 years, is now closing by exaggerating the supposed health effects of lead and things that are outrageous. So the Los Angeles Times and a number of the other major media just simply will not cover this issue in a fair way. And so it is a major problem. But we've got a number of smaller publications that are covering this. And there are opportunities to learn about it. What you're doing today and what you did in Reading is an effort to present the other side. There's also a website, killcarb.org, has a lot of information on it. And what Congress is doing. You're going to get a fair presentation with media in other parts of the country than in California.
Okay, we have two more.
Dr. Enstrom, this is Fred Grant again, and I, at the risk of making the board turned in rebellion against me over the lunch hour, I do want to ask you two things. First of all, your case against UCLA for wrongful firing as a shortcut, you won last week by settlement, UCLA offering that settlement, is that right?
Yes. Well, it's it's a compromise, but it is the best I can do.
But they didn't. They didn't want to go to jury. They didn't want to go to jury trial, and so they settled.
That's the basic consensus of my attorneys, and they did a phenomenal job. I got pro bono help. Saved my ability to function.
Okay, and has the Los Angeles Times, I haven't seen it, but have they run a story on that?
No, they will only run stories that are critical of me. They don't want to give anybody a notion that I've actually achieved something against UCLA, even though, like I said, like Lois Henry said, it's not slaying Goliath. Giving a black eye is a better word, but it's an opening. It's an opening to show that people like yourselves there at the hearing can have an impact. You don't have to take this from CARB anymore. You can actually try to understand the evidence. You can work with Congress. We can stop this. And we're not going to get any help from the Los Angeles Times or the officials within the University of California. They seem to want this agenda, and it's very sad.
And finally, we had testimony from Dr. Dunn, and you've mentioned it also, experiments on human beings, both adults and children, by exposing them to the particulates of diesel. Are you aware of any findings by any school that conducted those studies on human beings that showed damage to their health or safety from the ingestion directly of those particulates?
I'm not really familiar with the details of those studies, but to my knowledge, they did not find any permanent or serious problems. There may have been some temporary elevations of certain exposure levels or some indicator changes, but I'm not aware of any serious problems that were long-term. But again, this is out of my area of expertise. Okay.
Well, for example, one of the ladies who had a heart problem before being exposed to the fumes, to the exhaust fumes, did suffer a little heart tremor as a result of going in with the heart trouble. Were you aware of that?
No. Again, this is really out of my... area of expertise, I'm just giving a general impression that that there are many of these effects are somewhat transient. I'm not aware of any evidence that shows that certainly that diesel exhaust exposure actually kills anyone, which is what the claim is based on the epidemiologic studies I discussed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In view of that, and I didn't ask Dr. Dunn that, I should have, but we have a document put in indicating what the results were as physical exhibits.
Good, thank you.
Dr. Enstrom, unless there are other questions from the board members, I want to thank you very much for your time. Thank you for helping us try to present to the board information that gives them a basis for moving ahead. Thank you, sir.
Okay, you're certainly welcome, and I hope you continue to pursue this matter as aggressively as you can.
I think you can be sure of that.
Thank you, Doctor.